Hi all, Dr. Clark here again. And today we're going to talk about the superphyla Lophotrichozoans. The Lophotrichozoans include a bunch of groups, a bunch of phyla, and the one that we're going to talk about mainly today is Acoelomorpha. Now, before we get into Acoelomorpha, that phyla, which is pictured here, the Lophotrichozoans are normally just called kind of the flatworms. You can see these worm-like creatures. We're going to go into the anatomy, what makes up these Acoelomorpha. But before we get into that, we're going to talk about Lophotrichozoans from kind of an evolutionary perspective and a cladogram perspective, so you can get an idea of that grouping. Okay, so first it has to be said, though, that by lumping all these phyla into a superphyla called Lophotrichozoa, it is controversial. There are groups of scientists that do not believe that you should be lumping all these organisms together, and other groups of scientists that think that this is the best way to classify these guys in a monophyletic connection, with monophyletic connection. Nonetheless, there is some controversy, and this may change in the future. Near future, I should say. And if it does, then we'll teach whatever the grouping it is that they want to go with. So first off, the group consists of Acoelomorpha, Platyhelminthes, Nemerta, Gastrica, and Cyclophora. Cyclophora is a fairly new group, and it consists of two species. So it's a really small phyla and very different than some of these other groups, okay? But we're going to get into these groups and we're going to examine each one of these phyla that belong within this Lophotrichozoan grouping, okay? And so this is just a small grouping of Lophotrichozoans. We're going to talk about other groups of Lophotrichozoans, but today we're going to talk about this group, the flatworm group, which used to be called the Platyhelminthes group. And now it's broken up into five phyla. Okay. Now, moving from Cnidarians and Ctenophora, we now start to see that the Lophotrichozoans have distinct kind of body plans. In other words, in this system, all the organisms under Lophotrichozoan are triploblastic. They have three tissue types. Okay? Also, they're all exhibit bilateral symmetry. Okay? And in this small grouping, they are all acoelomates. Okay? And that's why I'm talking about the acoelomate Lophotrichozoans first. Then we'll talk about the coelomate Lophotrichozoans later. They're still all Lophotrichozoans. That's part of the controversy that persists over this lumping of these major phyla. Okay, so nonetheless, we're moving from Cnidarians and Ctenophoras, and we're getting more complex and have more body distinctions. Okay. So the flatworm or the flatworm group, you can see, this is a pretty good image to be able to divide this organism bilateral. You could just divide it down kind of the orange line that runs down its body. But again, it's going to have basically a right and a left side. And they're going to be superficially a mirror image of one another. And what I mean by that is, of course, you might have differences in a little bit of organ placement in the bilateral connection. But when we talk about if there was limbs present, you have a limb on each side, you same number of limbs on each side. If there's sensory organs present, you have the same number of sensory organs on each side. Okay, so often flatworms, as we progress into things like tubularians, okay, they'll have eye spots, and so you would have an eye spot on each side. Okay? And we'll look at this as we go through Lophotrichozoans. Okay, so here's that great group, Lophotrichozoa. Okay, and we're going to just be examining kind of this branch over here, the acoelomorpha branch, in the next few lectures. And then we'll look at the branch over here, the coelomorpha or coelomate branch. So acoelomate branch, sorry, and coelomate branch over here. Now, there will be some pseudocoelomates that we'll talk about, kind of that branch there, when we progress, okay? But Lophotrichosaurus has a monophyletic evolutionary connection or ancestry. Single ancestor gave rise to the Lophotrichosaurus. That's why this group exists. That's why it has evidence in that it has a monophyletic connection. There are still a lot of scientists out there that don't believe we should have this grouping because you're lumping major groups that are very different from each other in the same heading. Okay, and you'll see why when we start moving on and looking at some other things. Okay, so all animals under Lophotrichosaurus are bilateral symmetric, triploblastic. Okay, so they have an ectodermis, endodermis, and a mesodermis in between. Acoelomates. Okay, so they do not have a colon, and they we classify them into the five phyla. Okay, the five phyla are all based mainly on ribosomal RNA and a little bit of morphology. These features like bilateral symmetry, triploblastic, acoelomates. Okay, now there's some interesting pieces, and it's a point of, we're going to revisit this point fairly often, but there's this new kind of terminology for a sexually mature stage that I want you guys to know, and that's pedimorphism. Okay? Pedimorphism means that the juvenile stage can be reproductively active. And so you can have the hatching of an egg, in this case, the hatching of an egg, okay, or the budding of an organism if they can reproduce asexually. And then as they mature, they're still in their juvenile form, and instead of becoming the adult form, they stay in the juvenile form and they become reproductively active. Okay? We see it in this group, and we'll see it again in Echidiza, and then we'll see it again in Deuterostoma. And so it's a good example of what we call convergent evolution. We know that organisms that can display pedimorphism did not give rise to directly to another organism that displays pedimorphism because they're greatly different and they've been disconnected for a long time. So that means that that capability has, from an evolutionary term, has popped up twice or three times or four times or five times, independent of one another. And that's a really good sign of mechanisms that can evolve independent of each other, and it shows that, you know, a lot more evidence for the evolutionary change of organisms when you have pedimorphism or when you have these convergent evolution characteristics. And we'll talk more about pedimorphism as we move on. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the phyla Acoelomorpha, or what the new term for this phyla is Xenocoelomorpha, and Acoelomorpha is considered a subphyla. Now, I'm just prefacing this. Only some scientific communities accept Xenocoelomorpha as the phyla's name. Okay? Other scientific communities are still only accepting Acoelomorpha. So I'm presenting both, okay? Probably because more individuals are starting to switch over to Xenocoelomorpha than are holding fast on Acoelomorpha, okay? But regardless, Acoelomorpha, if it's not the phyla's name, it's the subphyla's name. So it's still related, it's not going away, and it's still representing these organisms. Acoelomates are what are typically called flatworms, or a flat acoelomate flatworm, or acoelomate worms. Okay, just like other loafer trichozoans, they are bilateral in symmetry, they're triploblastic, and they do not have a colon. These guys also do not have appendages. Okay, so they're truly like a worm, but they're not segmented. Okay, so here you can see them. They're aquatic species. Okay, you can see, just different variations. You can see kind of the stomach region or the gastrovascular region on these organisms. So they'll have a ventral side and a dorsal side, and on the ventral side they'll often have a mouth in the middle, right, or an opening. You can see it here, you can sort of see it here. These guys, you're looking at the dorsal side of the organism, so you can't see it. But nonetheless, that's their feeding apparatus. That's where they're going to feed, kind of in the middle of the body. And these guys are going to be both male and female. They're hermaphroditic. So you'd have testes and ovaries in the same region. And then you're also going to have kind of a gonadopore, a general purpose opening, okay, that's going to release either sperm or egg. Now, they're not self-fertilizing. We've talked about this before. There's very few organisms that will mix their own sperm and egg to produce a zygote. Most of them will produce sperm, release the sperm into the water column, and then another individual from the same species would be releasing eggs, sperm and egg come together, and you get fertilization occurring. And then that individual that released their sperm would then yolk up some eggs and produce some eggs, and that's kind of how sexual reproduction occurs in these organisms, these hermaphroditic organisms that occur in the water. When we get to terrestrial hermaphroditic organisms, it's a different story, okay? There's a different way at which they do reproduction because they're not just blasting the water column with a bunch of sperm and egg. They're normally doing internal fertilization, which we'll talk about, okay? So looking at the anatomy of acoelomorpha, or these flatworms, they have some unique systems. They have a proboscis sometimes, which allows them to, in some cases, penetrate the body of another organism with kind of a little proboscis. Other individuals do not have it. They all have a statocyst, which you can think of as similar to, like, I guess you could say a gyroscope in an airplane, in the sense that this is a system, it's fluid filled with cilia, and so this is a system that basically tells the organism what plane it is in the water. So if it's flipped over, then it would know that it's flipped over. If it's twisting or turning, okay, it knows it's moving in one direction versus the other. So this is a sensory organ. It's not a light sensory organ. So these guys are not able to detect light, okay? At least as far as we know, they're not able to detect light. But they can detect where they're at, basically, in the water column. Like I said before, going to have testes and ovaries in the same region. Okay? They're going to, pass those eggs out, the gonadopore. They're going to pass those testes out, etc., depending on, when they're ready. And the species, so certain species will do what we call protandry. They'll release sperm first and then their eggs, and then others, they just release their eggs first and then the sperm. So it just depends on the organism. Like I said, in the center of the organism, you're going to have a gut. Okay, it's not a stomach, but there are digestive enzymes in this region. This is where the digestion occurs. The mouth will allow for the organism to consume material. Okay? They have a makeshift pharynx, so they have a little tube that enters into the gut, and then you have the specialized cells in that region which are going to excrete digestive enzymes, digest the material, absorb the nutrients, and then pass the nutrients throughout the rest of the body. Okay, so fairly simplistic organism, but remember they have an ectodermis, an endodermis and a mesodermis in between, so they have true muscle cells. The parenchyma is this outer layer of kind of protection, okay? And so they're going to have this mucus protective layer. They don't produce a shell. We'll get to organisms that produce a shell, but they do have a little bit of protection to themselves. Now, the interesting piece, probably the most interesting piece about Acoelomorpha, is the development of a nerve net, a true nerve net in all organisms. Now, we saw a nerve net pop up when we were looking at cnidarians and Ctenophora. Okay? But the nerve net in Acoelomorpha is much more advanced, and it's much more unique in the sense that depending on what group or what either subphyla or class or what group of organisms you look at underneath Acoelomorpha, they're grouped out by kind of the placement of their nerve net or the structure of their nerve net, okay? Along with what does the statocyst look like, okay? So that gyroscope-like structure that tells them where they're at in the water column. What does that look like? Where is it placed relative to the nerve net? And then some other features like what's the internal, gastrovascular cavity look like? And where's the urogenital pore? What does that look like? That can play a role, but mainly the statocyst and that nerve net structure is what's kind of pointing to this phylogenetic tree or evolutionary tree underneath Acoelomorpha, okay? Which is interesting from the perspective of when we start advancing into some of the other Lophotrechozoans, we see how important that nerve net and then eventually ganglii or small brain plays in the evolution of organisms. Okay, so with that, we're going to move on to another group of Lophotrechozoans. We're going to talk about Platyhelminthes. It's a much larger group, much more diversity, and very different than Acoelomorpha.